Hello, everybody. Hope you all are doing good. My apologies for starting this webinar a bit late. To introduce, to start off myself, my name is Luqman Rafiq, and I'm going to be conducting this P7 session for the December 2017 examination. This is my second session that I would be conducting for the ACCA. Earlier, I did conduct the session in the last attempt, which was the September attempt. So I know a lot of the students would actually want to go for the namaz break. So we will take the namaz break, but let's just have a quick introduction, and then we could actually go on for the namaz. I would give a brief introduction of myself. My name is Luqman Rafiq, and I'm the Chief Executive Officer of ACC approved learning partner named the Scriber College, which has got campuses in various cities of Pakistan. So we've got campuses in Karachi, Sakhar, and Rawalpindi. So these are the three areas, three cities where we have got campuses in Pakistan. It's been 9 years that I have been teaching, and I've been teaching various qualifications like ACCA, ICAW, ICAP, and CIMA. These are the various qualifications that I have been teaching. The areas that I have actually taught have been the financial reporting, auditing, and to an extent, I have actually taught financial management also. So over a period of this 3 days, this in fact 5 days, what we are going to be doing is we are going to try and cover up the entire syllabus of P7. We are going to cover every single aspect of the course, and our main focus is going to be towards the exam practice. So that is what our main focus is going to be. A lot of you might have actually attempted P7 earlier. So those of you who have attempted P7 earlier, you do have an idea that what exactly is the overall curriculum of P7 all about. But those who have not attempted P7 earlier, I'm going to share that P7, when it comes to attempting P7, P7 actually builds on from the basics that you have acquired while studying ACCA paper F8 and ACCA paper P2. So it's actually F8 and P2 that you have already studied, which is actually examined at the P7 level. You would come across a lot of questions at the P7 examination, and while attempting those questions, you would think as if these are financial reporting questions. So let me tell you, yes, this does happen. This does happen, because what happens is you need to understand the very basic, which is that the auditing starts where the accounting ends. So as an auditor, you should know accounting well. If you don't know accounting well, you can't actually audit, because what happens is that we are performing the audit of financial statements, and while performing the audit of financial statements, we should know that how the financial statements are prepared, and etc., etc. So basically, it's all about having knowledge of accounting standards from P2, which you have already studied. So the P2 knowledge, accounting standard, is a very essential knowledge. Even in the most recent examiner did mention about the students having weak knowledge of the P2 standard, which actually relates to students not being successful in the examination. Last attempt, the result hasn't been very good. It has been, I think, around 31 or 32%. And this has been like this for some attempts now. But hopefully, we are hoping that you people would work on your weaknesses, and you people would try and overcome your weaknesses, and would try to actually be. You would try to overcome these weaknesses and try to pass the paper. To discuss a bit, P7 syllabus actually comprises of in total, it comprises of 7 sections. So the 7 sections of the syllabus are Section A, Section B, and Section C. The Section A, which is more of a regulatory environment. The main topic that is actually examined at this level is the money laundering, which is one of the main topics that is examined and which is examined in quite detail. Then the applications of the laws and regulations is also one of the areas that is examined. In addition to this, the Section B Code of Ethics, it's an area which is regular feature of the examination. Every attempt you'll find questions from this section of the exam. And then you've got Section C, which is quality control. So it's actually Section A, Section B, and Section C of the syllabus, which are examined in together. So you usually come across a question which comprises of a mixture of the knowledge that you have gained from these three sections, which is Section A, B, and C. The next is actually the audit of historical financial information. This is the key area, which to me from the examination perspective constitutes around 50% of the examination. So Section D, a very important section, constitutes around 50% of the examination. And then you've got other assignments with the audit related and assurance services. So this is also an area which you will be going through. And lastly, there are two more areas. One of them is a reporting area. So auditor report, a mandatory at least 20 mark area every attempt mandatory 20 marks area, and an area where there have been upgradations, where there have been improvements or updations in the previous few years. So last 1.5 year, there have been changes in the auditing standards pertaining to the audit reporting. So we are going to be going through them also. And lastly, the current issues, which is always a feature of a lot of professional level examinations of ACCA. So that's what the syllabus is all about. Before we move forward, I would like to take, let's say, I would want to take a 10-minute namaz break. So we can have a 10-minute namaz break and we can actually start off immediately after the prayers. So we are going to start off at we're going to start off at 6:25. So the session resumes at 6:25. Welcome back. So before the prayer break, we were having a discussion about the overall agenda of this entire P7 webinar over the 5 days, and we were also having a quick discussion about the way the paper is going to be, the way the syllabus is structured. So I'm just going to have a quick discussion about the way P7 is examined. So the way P7 is examined is there are two sections, which is section A, and there is another section, which is section B of the paper. So the method of P7 examination is different to the other professional level examinations, where in section A you don't have a 50 mark question. Instead, what happens is there is a question one, which is a 35 mark question, and there's a question two, which is a 25 mark question. At the same time, there are three questions in section B, which is question 3, question 4, and question 5. And each of the question is 20 marks, 20 marks, and 20 marks each. What you need to do is that you need to attempt 2 out of 3 questions over here. So it's actually 60 marks here, and you've got 40 marks here. That's how the session is divided. Now, what exactly is examined in these various questions? So the trend, I mean, it's not that the examiner has mentioned this thing, but I'm just sharing with you the trend of the examiner. And the trend of the examiner is actually this section D is examined in this area, which is the audit of historical financial statements. And this question number two, it could be either of section A, section B, and section C, or at times it is made up of section E. Or at times what happens is you come across a question which is of section D also. So basically at times you come across the entire section A, which is made up of section D of the exam of the syllabus. Then there is this question 3, question 4, and question 5. So if I talk about question 3, 4, and 5, so generally speaking, one of the questions is from the reporting section, which is the section F. One of them is either from section E or section D, and one of them is from section A, B, or C. So it entirely depends upon how the mixture is shuffled, depending upon how the examiner actually examines in question number in section A. So majorly, if you could see from the whole of it, it's the section D which is the key section. So you can't afford to miss out section D. At the same time, there is this section E and then the section A, B, and C. So the likelihood of those questions, likelihood of those areas of the syllabus which are going to be examined in section A cannot be ignored. So it's just the reporting section which is usually not examined in section A. Otherwise, everything is examined in section A of the syllabus. Now, before we proceed, what am I going to do is that I'm going to refer to this slide also, which is actually being given to you. So what happens is we are going to create an overall audit overview that what exactly is the overall audit process. So I'm going to discuss the overall audit process that what exactly is the audit all about, how is it conducted, what are the various steps of the audit. So generally, if I discuss about the audit, that how exactly is audit conducted, so there is actually a process of conducting the audit, and amongst that process there are various steps, and that includes the first stage, which is the tendering for the audit. And then the second stage of the audit is actually when we talk about this tendering, that's first stage of the audit. And in addition to tendering, you've got the engagement letter. There is the second stage of the audit. And in addition to the engagement letter, the third stage of the audit is actually the audit planning. And after the audit planning, what happens is we move on to, once the audit planning is completed, so what we do is that we next move on to the performance stage of the audit. And then after the performance stage of the audit, there is the finalization or the review stage of the audit. So there is this finalization or the review stage of the audit. And once the finalization and the review stage of the audit is done, so then there is actually a reporting stage of the audit. So this is how the overall audit is conducted. So if I actually talk about the way the audit is conducted, so this is the overall audit process, which is you start from the tendering stage. Then the next stage is actually the signing of the engagement letter. The third stage is actually the planning stage. The fourth is the performance stage. And the fifth is the finalization or the review stage. Now, I'm going to discuss step by step, and I'm going to relate this areas of the audit to the syllabus section. So the point is section A, section B, and section C of the syllabus, along with the section A, section B, or section C of the syllabus is actually applicable to this area of the audit, which is the tendering and the engagement letter stage. Then we have got the planning stage and the performance stage. So this planning and performance stage and the finalization stage, this is all section D of the syllabus. And then what happens is this reporting stage, which is actually the section F of the syllabus. So this is how the syllabus is being reflected in the overall audit process. And obviously the section E covers up the assurance engagement or the other engagement, which are not covered, which are not part and parcel of the audit. They are other than the audit. So now, if I talk about these steps one by one, so what am I going to do is that I'm going to refer to these slides, which is actually the slides which are being shared with you. So the first stage of actually audit is the tender stage, where you tender for the audit. So whenever we talk about the tendering of the audit, so tender actually means, if I say that what exactly do we mean by tender, so tender actually means that you quote for the audit. So you quote for the audit, that is considered to be the tender stage of the audit. So when we talk about this tendering stage of the audit, so the question mark that arises is, why do we quote? So it could either be that we might actually be invited to tender, or we might have actually approached the client on our own. So these could be the two possibilities that could happen when it comes to tendering for the audit. So whenever we tender for the audit, so one thing that needs to be considered is that if you are tendering for the audit, you need to make sure that you just don't go and you just don't actually, I mean, whenever you are tendering for the audit, so you need to make sure that you just don't go out and you just give the quotation to the client. There are several issues which need to be considered, and what exactly are those issues, we are going to discuss them one by one. So the number one of them is actually the ethical issue that you need to consider. And when we talk about the ethical issue, so what is an ethical issue? So ethical issue is basically you've got the whole of the code of ethics. So the code of ethics describes the various fundamental ethical principles, various threats to the ethical threats that might arise in a given such a situation. So you as an auditor need to consider that if there are no, you as an auditor, you need to consider that, are there any ethical scenarios? Are there any ethical issues that are arising? If there are any ethical issues that are arising in the given scenario, then what you actually need to do is that you should not go ahead with the auditor. You should try to manage those ethical issues. Then there is this legal issue. And what exactly do you mean by having a legal issue? So legal issue is whenever we talk about this legal issue. So if I say that the legal issues when it comes to tendering for the audit, so legal issues may be that you need to consider that are we legally allowed to conduct this audit? Does that, like in every country, there is a company law or a company's act that actually governs the way the companies have to run. So that actually does describe the minimum qualifications for an auditor for any entity. So you need to consider as an auditor that, considering the laws and regulations that are prevalent, so are you eligible to perform the audit of this client? Now, the next situation that you actually need to do is that the third thing is the commercial issue. And the commercial issue is that, are we going to benefit anything out of this audit? Are we going to benefit out of this audit? Are we going to get anything out of this audit? So that's also an important thing. And lastly, there is a professional issue. which is are we I mean, is it not going, is it should will it hurt our profession if we are going to be affiliated or associated with this specific entity? So you need to consider that if it is professionally acceptable for you to accept this engagement or not. So the first thing is we go for the tendering stage, which is we quote for the audit. We actually tell the client that this is what we are going to charge, this is how we are going to conduct the audit. So while quoting and while tendering for it, you need to consider all these four issues. The next stage for the audit is actually the signing of engagement letter. So the next stage for the audit is the signing of engagement letter. Now, when I actually talk about signing of the engagement letter, so what exactly is an engagement letter? That's the second step of the audit. So once basically what happens is at times we do quote, we do quote, and there are negotiations that actually take place. And while conducting those negotiations, there are things that move up and down. So what you need to make sure is that once you have actually agreed with the client, then there should be an engagement letter that needs to be signed. So engagement letter is just like a contract that we would actually perform, the contract or an agreement that we would sign for any other contract. So the engagement letter, when it comes to audit, is just a contract that is binding both the parties that this is these are the terms and conditions that we have agreed. And anything other than these terms and conditions is not going to be considered as an acceptable thing. So what is going to constitute our arrangement is what is mentioned in the engagement letter. So now, if I say that what are the things that are considered in the engagement letter, so number one of them is the engagement letter prescribes the scope of the engagement. That what is exactly is the scope? Is it going to be an audit, or is it going to be a review, or is it going to be something else? So that's what the engagement letter tells you. The next thing is the timings, because what happens is when it comes to audit, a lot of companies will want to publish their results as early as possible. So if a company wants to publish its results as early as possible, the company would obviously insist upon its auditor that you need to get the thing done at a specific point of time. So that is also important, that what are going to be the timings for the audit. The third of them is the opinion, or the form of opinion, or the form of report. So every country, like we do have a standardized report in ISA, but every country has got a specific type of a report. So when we talk about a country to country, to it actually depends which country you are in. Like in Pakistan, we have got a different type of report. In UK, there is a different type of a report, because the UK's Companies Act, it prescribes a different format for the audit report. So an auditor needs to have a clearer understanding from the client that what sort of audit report format that is going to be used between us. And the other terms and conditions, which is going to be what is going to be the fee, what is going to be the timing, what is going to be the out-of-pocket expenses that you are going to pay to us. So all these things need to be considered. So these are the first two steps of the audit, which is actually you tender for the audit, and at the same time, while tendering for the audit, once the tender or the quotation is accepted, you get the engagement letter signed. The next step is the planning stage of the audit. And what exactly is the planning stage of the audit? So we will have a quick review of the planning stage, that what exactly are the things that are considered at the planning stage. So if I say that what happens at the planning stage of the audit, so when it comes to planning stage of the audit actually starts off as soon as the engagement is accepted. So as soon as the engagement letter is signed or the engagement is accepted, the audit planning starts. Now, who actually performs the planning? So it's generally the audit planning is performed by the senior personnel in the audit firm, because planning is a higher level task. Planning is one of those tasks which actually sets the tone of how the audit will be conducted, which actually highlights the risk areas and etc. So when we perform the audit planning, so in performing the audit planning, we decide overall all the things, which is what is going to be the overall audit strategy, what are going to be the timings of the various actions that we are going to perform during the course of this audit, and what is going to be the overall direction of the audit. So these are the important things that at the planning stage, which actually are discussed, or which actually are done. This involves a lot of things, so just wait for a while and we are going to come on to the planning, that what exactly does the planning involve. Then the next step which is involved in the audit planning is the understanding of the entity and its environment. To be precise, it's the application of ISA 315. So we apply ISA 315, which is the understanding of the entity and its environment. So that's what we do while we perform the audit. The next step is the assessment of the risk of material misstatement. So this is then again part of ISA 315, some part of ISA 320 is applicable also, which is to setting out the materiality. So that's what we do. And the last thing is that once we have highlighted the risk, so after highlighting the risk, what we do is that we plan the responses towards the risk, that what are going to be our responses towards these risks. So these are the two steps of the audit that are actually done. So these are the two steps. Now, the third step for the audit is actually the performance stage of the audit. Now, what exactly is the performance stage of the audit? So if I explain the performance stage is one of those stages where actually the audit procedures are performed. Performance stage is the stage where the audit procedures are performed. And when it comes to the performance stage, the audit procedures are performed, and what you do is that you gather the audit evidence through this performance stage of the audit. So when we talk about the performance stage of the audit, so we do gather the audit evidence from the performance stage of the audit. Now, if I actually talk about this performance stage, so generally at the performance stage, we perform the audit procedures and we try to gather the evidence. And our focus is actually that we should be able to gather sufficient and appropriate audit evidence. That's what our focus is. And once the performance stage is done and the procedures have been performed, so the next step for the audit is actually the review or the finalization stage. Now, this review or the finalization stage is the stage where usually your senior manager, or where usually your partner, these are the people who would actually get engaged in the review of everything. So this finalization or the review stage is an area where they are actually going to indulge into it. They would review the working papers and they would actually assess if sufficient and appropriate audit evidence has been obtained or not. So if they believe that sufficient and appropriate audit evidence has been obtained, so what they would do is that they would give a go ahead for the finalization or for the reporting. But in case if they think that sufficient or appropriate audit evidence has not been obtained, then they would actually recommend that additional audit procedures be performed. So basically what happens at the finalization stage is the partner or the senior manager or the manager, he actually reviews the work. He reviews the working papers, and while reviewing the working papers, they do perform a question mark that do we have the sufficient and appropriate audit evidence? If they do have the sufficient and appropriate audit evidence, they go for the reporting. If they do not have the sufficient and appropriate audit evidence, they perform additional audit procedures. So once the review stage passes, the next step is actually. Once the review stage passes, the next step is actually the reporting stage. So if I actually talk about the reporting stage, what is the reporting stage? Let's just talk about it. So you've got the entire ISA 700 series for this audit reporting, and there is another series, ISA 800, which is not actually covered at the P7 level. So ISA 700 series, this actually governs the whole of the audit opinion, and you do have an idea either there is going to be an unmodified opinion, or there might be a qualified opinion, or there might actually be an adverse opinion, or there might actually be a disclaimer of opinion. So what are the circumstances where we give an unmodified opinion? What are the circumstances where we give adverse opinion or a qualified opinion? So we are going to discuss all of them together. So overall, if I actually summarize whatever that I have discussed in the past half an hour, so you would actually figure out this thing that I have actually discussed, the audit overview. I've talked about what the audit is all about. I've discussed the overall audit, that what the audit is all about and what are the various steps of the audit. So this is actually setting out the scene. Now you have an idea that what are the various steps of the audit. What am I going to do now is that I'm now going to move forward, and I'm going to actually discuss the planning stage of the audit. And once I'm done with the planning stage, then I'll move on to the exam questions. So before I proceed, I would want to actually take the questions that the students have actually raised. Anybody has any questions? Okay, anybody has any questions? Please go ahead. Okay, just wait. Okay, I'm gonna answer one of them, each one of them. What is meant by professional issues? So when we talk about the professional issues actually means that you see. As a if let's say if we talk about Big Four like PwC or the KPMGs or the EYs or the Deloittes, these audit firms would want to be associated or would want to be conducting the audit of a client who has a good history or has got a good reputation. Like for example, if PwC accepts the audit of an entity which is involved in drug trafficking business or the human trafficking business, so that would actually damage the professional placement of PwC as a good audit firm. The direction is how the overall audit is going to be conducted, what are going to be the staff that we would be hiring, will we be needing the work of an expert or not. Sumaya, this ISA are important, but the point is at P7 level examiner has kept a lot of marks for the application, not for the rote learning. So ISAs are important, but then again, it's actually what is more important is being able to handle the scenarios or apply your knowledge onto them. Yes, there is a WhatsApp group. We would actually share the link in a while. Chandan, I do understand that my writing is pathetic, but the problem is that it doesn't actually get better. So when I'm going to be writing some questions and answers to it, I would be using the Word format. Don't worry about it. Junaid, you don't need to write ISA in the exam. Professional issues, I think, Farasat, I have elaborated. Junaid, I have explained. Okay, Anas, the final stage and which is the review stage of the audit are also termed as the finalization stage of the audit. What exactly is this finalization stage of the audit? Generally, what happens is once the junior team has performed the procedures, once they have gathered the audit evidence, then what happens is that such working papers are reviewed by the senior manager or a partner. So the review by them that whether sufficient and appropriate audit evidence has been obtained or not is actually the review phase. Naveed, I think you should wait for reporting. I'll come on to it. Money laundering, Sajid Ali, is overall. And you need to initially assess at the time of accepting the client that are they engaged in money laundering or not. And at the same time, this practice continues overall. Osama, yes, engagement letter is sent by firm to the client. Timing and planning is when are the various procedures going to be performed. So when it comes to timing in the planning stage, that's actually going to be when are the various procedures going to be performed. Yes, generally, Janet, yes, they are the same. But actually, what happens is, at times, if there is a high-risk client, then you have other partner who actually goes through it. Anas, for those who are actually who have actually been not been able to pass the exam, Sajid, these general questions, I would warn that the general question pertaining to P7 should be asked at the end of the session today. But right now, if you have a questions with respect to whatever that I have taught or whatever that I've discussed in the last half an hour or so please have questions pertaining to that, pertaining to your questions, we would discuss it at the end of the session. Okay, so now let's move forward and let's just discuss further that how exactly are things going to move further. Now, okay, now, so basically we did actually talk about what exactly do we mean by audit planning. Now, what is the next step? The next step is actually to discuss what exactly does this planning involve. So when I'm going to talk about the audit planning, I'm going to discuss that the audit planning is actually based upon ISA 300. So it's actually the ISA 300 and the ISA 300 series, that's what the planning actually involves. So the number one thing that I'm actually going to talk about is that whenever we talk about the planning stage of the audit, so planning actually starts off by setting out the overall audit strategy, planning out the timings of the various procedures, planning out the timings at which the various procedures are going to be performed, and the overall way that how the audit is going to be conducted is considered to be direction. Like for example, at this stage you need to plan out that how much staff would we be needing for this client. You need to plan out, will we be needing the work of an expert? When are we going to be performing the various tasks like inventory count, cash count, etc., etc.? So that's also an important aspect. So you need to actually be able to perform these. You need to be able to plan out, because whenever you are planning the audit of the financial statements, so you need to understand that what are the various what is the overall business environment. Is it a very technical company? Are we going to be needing an expert? Do we have the internal expertise, or do we need to have an expert on board, etc., etc.? So this is what the overall thing is. Then the next step is actually we talk about the either 315, which is understanding of the entity and its environment and assessing the risk of material misstatement. So this is the most important area at the planning stage of the audit, and I'm going to discuss one by one every single aspect of this either 315. So first of all, if I talk about this either 315, so either 315 actually starts off like this, that either 315 actually states that while at the planning stage of the audit, the first thing that we need to perform is we need to obtain an understanding of the entity. The first thing that we need to perform is we need to obtain an understanding of the entity. Now, when we talk about obtaining an understanding of the entity, so what exactly do we mean by taking an understanding of the entity? So you need to understand the entity because you are performing the audit. So it's actually understanding everything, which is the overall business structure, the operating cycle, the supply chain, or the changes during the year. Generally, this understanding of the entity is usually a very critical part when it comes to the first year of audit. So whenever you've got the first year of audit, so in the first year of audit, this understanding is a very critical part of the audit. Now, why is this understanding a very critical part of the audit in the first year? Because you don't know the entity. You don't know anything about that entity. So you need to actually, you need to be more, you need to be more, you need to have a more questioning attitude. You need to ask more and more questions from the management. You need to understand the entity more and more so that you are able to plan better with respect to the audit. So you need to understand the overall business structure, which is who is the parent entity. You need to understand who is the subsidiary entity. You need to understand who is an associate or who is a joint venture. You need to understand, are there any branch operations? You do need to understand, I mean, you need to understand all of these things. So are there any branch operations or etc., etc.? Then what is the overall operating cycle of the business? Like if I talk about the textile sector in Pakistan, the textile sector in Pakistan has got a very serious issue, and that serious issue is that the textile sector requires a 6-month credit period. So everybody over here in textile sector actually needs to work on a 6 months credit. So the overall the cycle, the working capital cycle becomes a very longer cycle. At times you have to buy the yarn at cash price, and you have to actually sell. You have to sell things at credit. So you need to finance your working capital for the 6 months. And if there are larger orders, you can't actually take those orders till the time you are guaranteed that you're gonna get the money or no, etc. So you need to understand the overall operating cycle. You need to understand the other operating cycle of the business. That is it a seasonal business or is it a regular business? What are the factors that affect the sales of the business? What are the factors that affect the profitability of the business? So you need to understand every single aspect pertaining to this business. The next thing is you need to understand the supply chain, which is where does this business purchases goods from? Where does it sell? Whom does it purchases from? Are the goods transported to this business? What are the timings at which the purchases should be recognized? What are the timings at which the sale should be recognized? So this is all a very important aspect, because ultimately we are obtaining understanding about the entity because because we need to actually perform the audit of financial statements, and the financial statements are directly affected by all of these things. The next is basically the changes during the year. Now, what exactly are the changes during the year? A very important aspect that you should know what changes have taken place with respect to the business. Now, what changes have taken place with respect to business, if I talk about it, so I would say that the changes that might actually take place with respect to business is that subsidiary sold. Associate sold, or you might have actually taken a new subsidiary, or you might have actually closed down operations of a segment or a business location. So there might actually be the things which you might have performed. So you need to obtain the complete understanding of the entity. And it is not just about understanding of the entity, it's about understanding the entity's environment also. Now, a very important point is you need to understand the entity's environment also. Now, when we say what exactly do we mean by understanding the entity's environment, so let's just have a quick discussion about understanding the entity's environment. Now, first of all, when we talk about entity's environment, understanding of the entity's environment, so what we are going to do is that we are going to discuss that what exactly do we mean by the entity's environment. So the environment could actually be the internal environment. The entire environment could actually be the external environment. So whenever we talk about understanding of the entity environment, it could either be an internal or it could either be an external environment. So now, we do need to understand the external environment of the entity, which is that the external environment would involve everything, the governments, the customers, the legislative changes, the competitors and everything. So an easier approach to understanding the environment is applying the P3 models to it. And what are the P3 models that you are going to apply? One of them is going to be the PESTEL, and the other one of them is going to be the Porter 5 forces. Now, if I talk about this PESTEL and the Porter 5 forces, so let's just talk about the Porter 5 forces and the PESTEL. So you see, you need to have a complete understanding of whatever the political, the economic, social, technological, and the ecological or the legislative changes that are going to affect this entity. So because you see, they have a direct relationship with the entities. These things have a direct relationship with the entity's financial statements. Now, let me give you an example, which is technology. Now, if there is a technological advancement, the effect of technological advancement is that your existing products, the effect of technological advancement is your existing products, they become out of date. So if they become out of date, there is possibility that they need to be written down. They need to be written down. The effect of the technological advancement is that your plant and machinery, there is going to be an impairment in your plant and machinery. So now, if there is going to be an impairment in your plant and machinery, then what do you need to do? You need to actually test them for the impairment. You need to test them for the impairment. That's also another important thing that happens. So basically, understanding of the environment is also very important, because once you understand the environment, then you can actually have an idea that where exactly is the risk gonna lie, because ultimate thing is we need to understand that what exactly is going to be an issue with the financial statement. That's what we are there to understand. So you need to understand the entity's external environment also. And in addition to the external environment, what is also important is to understand the internal environment of the entity, to understand the internal environment of the entity. When we talk about understanding of the internal environment of the entity, so internal environment of the entity would actually means that how good the internal controls are. I mean, are they in place? And at the same time, if they are in place, so are they effective internal controls or not? So these are the important things that you need to actually understand. So is the organization having a standard operating procedures? Are there any standard operating procedures? Or are there no standard operating procedures? What exactly is happening with this organization? Because the stronger the internal control, the auditor can actually rely on controls and he could reduce the level of substantive testing. But the weaker the controls are, the auditor would have to rely more and more on the substantive testing. Lastly, which is the assessing of the risk of material misstatement. Now, this is the very important area. So we are actually gonna Okay, so the third thing is which is assessing the risk of material misstatement. So let me actually discuss the risk of material misstatement. I'm going to discuss about the risk of material misstatement. Now see, what exactly do you mean by risk of material misstatement? Let's discuss. If I talk about the risk of material misstatement, if I talk about the risk of material misstatement, so what exactly is the risk of material misstatement? Risk of material misstatement is a risk that financial statements are materially misstated. The risk that financial statements are materially misstated. So one of them is financial statements are materially misstated. Now, a very important point is what exactly do you mean by materially misstated financial statements? So we need to fix two things. What is materially and what is misstated? When we talk about materially, so ISA 320 actually governs materiality, and ISA 320 gives you guidance that what is materiality all about. So whenever we talk about ISA 320, so ISA 320 actually guides you that the materiality is a very judgmental thing. Materiality is a very judgmental thing. I mean, when we talk about materiality, it's quite judgmental. But practically, what we do is that we use certain thresholds for materiality, and the thresholds that we use is for the profit before tax, there is a 5% threshold. For the total assets, for the revenues, for the total assets, there is a 2% threshold. And for the revenue, there is a 1% threshold, which generally prescribes materiality. So, for example, if an entity has got a profit of, let's say, 100,000, 100 million, so 5% of this makes it 5 million. If there is a loss on disposal in the financial statement of, let's say, 7 million, so this 7 million upon 100, which is the profit, gives you 7%. So this is actually going to be material. So the materiality threshold or the materiality limit was established to be 5 million for the profit before tax. So number one of them is what is materiality? So materially misstated means number one of them is judgmental element, and then profit before tax, it's 5% of the PBT, it's 2% of the total assets, and it's 1% of the total revenue. That is what is considered to be materiality. Now the second thing is what is considered to be misstatement of financial statement. Now whenever we do talk about misstatement of financial statement, One thing that you actually need to understand when it comes to misstatement is that the misstatement could be considered from two levels. One of them is a non-compliance with accounting standard. The one of the aspect is non-compliance with the accounting standards. So one of the area is actually non-compliance with the accounting standards. The second one of them is the non-validity of the assertion. Now, what exactly do you mean by non-compliance with accounting standards? So number one thing is that the accounting standards actually prescribe you the accounting for the various items or the various aspects. So like for example, if IAS 16 provides you guidance for the property, plant and equipment, and if an entity does not follow the provision of IAS 16 for accounting for its property, plant and equipment, then that's a misstatement. Now, what could actually be the level of misstatement? The level of misstatement could be that you had to measure the asset initially at its cost. And instead of measuring it at its cost, you have measured the asset at fair value. That could be the initial, that could actually be one of the errors that you've made. You were supposed to actually depreciate the asset over the useful life, and what you have done is you have depreciated the asset over the economic life. So these are actually misstatements. So whenever we talk about the misstatements, so misstatement actually means that a non-compliance with accounting standard has taken place. That's what the misstatement is all about. So whether that be, because you see, when we talk about an accounting standard, generally the areas or the things that are considered in the accounting standards actually include the scope of the accounting standard. Generally, the things that include are the scope of the accounting standard. Then there is this recognition criteria. Then there is this measurement criteria. And then there is this the subsequent measurement criteria. Furthermore, there is this derecognition. And after derecognition, there is this disclosure. So basically, if there is a non-compliance with respect to any of these things, that is all going to be considered as a misstatement. So you need to understand that if there is a non-compliance with respect to any of these things, whether that be that a certain thing did not fall under the scope of the standard and you have applied the relevant standard to it, that means you have actually done the non-compliance of a standard, and that is misstatement. If there is a recognition criteria that asset should be recognized and the probable future economic benefits will flow and you've not followed that, there is a misstatement. If you have actually not done the measurement in accordance with the standard, that's misstatement. If you have not measured them subsequently the way they should have been, that's misstatement. All the derecognition or the disclosure. And the second one of them is a non-validity of the assertions. So when I talk about actually the non-validity of the assertion, so whenever we talk about the assertions, so the audit assertions, what exactly do you mean by assertions? What exactly is the general concept of assertions? So assertions are declarations by management. Assertions are declarations by management. That the financial statement that they have prepared actually comply with all of these things. And what exactly are these? So I usually remember, may ask students to remember this using the mnemonic of C square compare. So I usually ask, tend to ask my students to remember this using the mnemonic of C square compare. Now, whenever we talk about this C square compare as being the mnemonic used to remember these audit assertions, so what exactly are these assertions? So let's just have a quick discussion about them one by one. So if I talk about them one by one, number one of them is a classification. What exactly do you mean by classification? That a property, plant, and equipment is being correctly classified as a PPE and it's not being classified as an investment property. That's one of the classification assertion. Then there is a completeness assertion, which is 100% of assets, 100% of liability, 100% of income, 100% of expenses have been recorded or have been recognized. Then we have got a cutoff, which is the correct period, which is the transactions, the expense, or the income for the correct period have been recorded. Then there is this occurrence assertion, and what does it mean? That the transactions have taken place. Then there is a measurement, which is it's correctly measured in accordance with the accounting standard. Then there is this presentation, which is that they've been presented correctly in accordance with IAS 1 or the relevant standard. The accuracy is that the transactions have been correctly recorded. Like if there is a purchase of 45, 425, so it has not been recorded as 45, 542. So that is what the accuracy assertion is. The rights and obligation is you say that the assets that we have shown as our assets, we have got rights to use those assets. The obligations that we have shown as our own obligations, they are our own obligations. And lastly, physical existence of the asset. So this is all an important area. So whenever we do talk about the audit planning, so this is generally what happens when it comes to audit planning. So now, if I actually summarize or sum up what I have actually discussed up till now, so I've discussed up till now that whenever we do perform the audit, so the audit has got the various stage, which is the tendering and the engagement letter, and then there is this planning and the performance and the finalization. And when we talk about the planning stage of the audit, so planning stage involves understanding of the entity, understanding of its environment, and assessing the risk of material misstatement. So as an auditor, before starting the audit, you need to ensure that you perform the entire planning, you identify these issues, you identify these problems. That's what you need to do as an auditor. So this is a general overview. We are now going to take a short break of 10 minutes. Then we are actually going to start off with a new question. So I'm going to take a short 10-minute break. Okay, welcome back. So, before the break, we had a discussion about what exactly is the risk of material misstatement. So, we had a discussion about it. Now, what we are going to do is that we are now going to move forward and we are going to start doing one of the questions. So, if you use your screen, this GoToWebinar screen, you would come across actually what you are going to do is that you're going to come across there is a section which is called the handout section. So in the handout section, you will find that there are two exam papers attached. If somebody has got a hard copy, then it's good enough. If you don't have a hard copy, then again you can download it from the ACCA's website. Okay, so what I would want you to do is that you open up this exam paper, which is actually March and June 2017. You open up this exam paper and March, June 2017 exam paper, and you need to actually come on to this question number. You need to come on to the question number one, which is about the Laurel Group. So, what you need to actually do is that you need to do the question number one, March, June 2017. If I just go through the basics of this question. So it's March, June 2017, Laurel Group. Please go through this question and its requirement. And what we are going to do is that we are going to then start discussing about it. So basically, if you go through the requirement of this question, the question's requirement is actually the question's requirement is evaluate the risk of material misstatement to be considered in planning the group audit. Your evaluation should utilize the analytical procedure as a method for identifying the relevant risk. And then number two, it says recommend any additional information. which should be requested from the group, which would allow a more detailed preliminary analytical review. Recommend the principal audit procedures to be performed. And lastly, it says that you need to perform the procedures on the impairment of so and so. So it's March, June 2017. And what you need to do is that you need to perform, you need to attempt this question number one of March, June 2017. Okay, if I talk about the requirements of this question, the question says that evaluate the risk of material misstatement. The question says that you need to evaluate the risk of material misstatements to be considered. So what do we need to do? We need to evaluate the risk of material misstatements to be considered in planning the group audit. Your evaluation should utilize the analytical procedure as a method for identifying the risk. So what I'm actually going to do is that I'm going to discuss about few things. Number one, risk of material misstatement. So number one thing is the risk of material misstatement. Now, we have discussed that what exactly is the risk of material misstatement. So whenever we talk about the risk of material misstatement, there are two things. One of them is materiality and the other one of them is a misstatement. These are the two things which actually happen. So one of them is a materiality and the other one of them is a misstatement. Now, ISO 315 actually tells you that while understanding the entity and its environment, you have to perform the following procedures. You have to perform the following procedures while performing the, while understanding the entity and its environment. And what are the various procedures that we need to perform? So one of them is the inquiry. The other one of them is the observation. And the third one of them is the analytical procedures. So these are the three. So these are the three things that we actually need to perform when it comes to ISO 315, which is actually about the inquiry, observation, and the analytical procedures. Now, so if I say that, what exactly do you mean by inquiry? So inquiry actually refers to that whenever we do talk about this inquiry would actually means that you are asking questions. And whom are you going to be asking the questions? You're going to be asking the questions from the management. You're going to be asking the questions from the staff. You're going to be asking the questions from connected people from whom you could actually get the information about the entity. So that is actually considered as an inquiry. The number one and number two of them is actually the observation. And what is the observation? The observation is watching things happen. So if you need to actually perform the observation with respect to an entity, so whenever we do talk about an entity's observation, so you could visit the factory, you could visit the premises, and you could see how things are operating at an entity. And the third one of them is the analytical procedure, which is actually covered up by ISA 520. Now, whenever we do talk about the analytical procedures, analytical procedure is actually the study of relationship. The analytical procedure is the study of relationship. Now, what is this analytical procedure, the study of relationship? It's the study of relationship between the various numbers. It's a study of relationship between numbers. So whatever numbers that are there in the financial statement, numbers in financial statement, whatever numbers that are there in financial statements, You need to actually understand the relation between those numbers. You need to understand the relation between those numbers, and the relation between those numbers will give you a lot of insight about the risk of material misstatement. Now, how do we perform the analytical procedures? So we perform the analytical procedures through the various things. Number one of them is through the ratio analysis. Number two is from the trend analysis. Number three is actually from the reasonableness check. So if we do perform the analytical procedures, so how do we actually perform the analytical procedures? We perform the analytical procedures by using either the ratio analysis or the trend analysis or the reasonableness check. Now, what exactly is analytical procedure? What exactly do they reflect? So if I talk about these analytical procedures, so you would actually consider number one of them is, let's say, the trend analysis. So if I talk about the trend analysis, maybe possible we talk about the change in sales. Assume that there is a sales growth that you have calculated for a company and it turns out to be 45%. You're going to compare this with the last year, or you're going to compare this with a competitor. So let me discuss that, then we talk about this trend analysis. So assume that there is a sales growth of 45%. You're going to compare this sales growth with the last year's sales of the entity, or with the sales growth of the competitor, or maybe the sales growth of the industry. So you're going to compare it with this. Assuming that the industry has a growth of only, let's say, 22%, then you would actually raise question mark. You would raise fingers that why is it that this entity has 45% and the whole industry has got only 22%? That why exactly is this company having a 45% growth and the whole industry having a 22% growth? So if I actually talk about it, then what happens is, as an auditor, what you need to do is that you need to actually raise a question mark that what is happening. There might actually be a cutoff issue that has resulted in sales pertaining to the next period being recognized in the current period. There might actually be an issue of fictitious sale that the entity, in order to enhance its sales, the entity has actually recorded fictitious sales. That could also be one of the things. So amongst the multiple things, what could happen is the cutoff issue could be there, the fictitious sales could be there. There could be also an issue of revenue recognition criteria not being met. Revenue criteria not met, that could also be another issue. So these are the various things that you need to consider. So when we talk about the trend analysis, so in order to talk about the trend analysis, that's what we do. We see that if the sales have grown by 45%, that is it in line with the industry growth? Is it in line with the competitor's growth? Is it in line with the last year's performance? What exactly has happened? If it is not in line, then there must be something seriously wrong. That's what the trend analysis reflect. Now, next step. We talk about the GP, the gross profit. Assuming that the gross profit has increased by, let's say, 25%. Now, first of all, if the sales have grown by 45%, then why is it the case that the GP has grown by 25%? Why has the GP grown by 25%? There has to be a question mark that needs to be raised. So the analytical procedure, they're going to give you an insight of to what is happening. So there has to be something seriously wrong. Either the cost of goods sold have been overstated. How would they be overstated? They would be overstated, might be because of the misclassification of expenses. Like the entity might have actually classified the operating expenses into COGS. That could be one of the things. So as an auditor, when we talk about the assessment of the risk of material misstatement, we perform the analytical procedure, and out of the analytical procedures, we actually do identify that what is actually going wrong. Is everything okay, or where exactly is the risk falling, or where exactly is the risk lying? The next situation. You perform various ratios. For example, you calculate the inventory holding period. For example, you calculate the inventory holding period. The question mark when it comes to inventory holding period is, you might actually say that the inventory holding period in the current year is 55 days as compared to the 43 days in the last year. Okay. So the above indicates that there is a slow moving inventory. Now, if there is a slow moving inventory, that means this is a hint of obsolescence. Now, what do we need to do? So from the perspective of the risk of material misstatement, we say that there is a risk that entity has not written down, inventory to the lower of cost or NRV, resulting in overstatement of inventory and profit. Furthermore, you could calculate the ratio of receivable days. You could calculate the receivable days. When we talk about the receivable days would actually indicate that whenever we actually talk about the receivable days, we could say that if the receivable days in the last year were 40 days versus the current year of 65 days, this indicates slow recovery of receivable, and slow recovery of receivable is actually an indication that there is a risk of bad debts. Now, what should an entity do? An entity should revise its allowance for bad debts. So as an auditor, you need to see, have they updated the allowance for bad debt? If they have not, that means the profit and receivable are overstated. So basically, when we perform analytical procedures are simply, you use the financial statements, you perform the trend analysis, you perform the ratio analysis, and you try to identify if everything is okay. If everything is not okay, that means there has to be a risk of material misstatement. So before we start discussing, you go on and you start attempting this question, and we are going to start discussing this question in 5-6 minutes time. So take 5-6 minutes time and then we'll discuss. Okay, so now, if any one of you could please share with me, if any one of you could please share with me the various ratios that you have actually calculated. So that is actually going to be it is going to be good for me so that I could actually proceed and I could go ahead with it. So okay, let's just try to calculate few things. The number one of them is basically you need to calculate the revenue change. If I talk about this entity, you need to calculate the revenue change. So how much is the revenue growth? Okay, revenue has increased by 12%, and the okay, so the revenue has grown by 12%. And what about the operating expenses? What has happened with the operating expenses? So the operating expenses have increased by 17%. Okay, and what about the gross profit? Okay, it has decreased by the operating gross profit has decreased by 5.4%. Gross profit, do we have, are we able to calculate the gross profit in this given scenario? You can't calculate the gross profit in this scenario. The operating profit could be calculated. The operating profit has decreased by 5.4%, and the profit before tax or the profit for the year is gone down by 7.41%. So it's the operating profit. And what has happened with the net profits? Net profit has gone down by 7.4%. In addition to this, if we actually talk about, so this is what has happened. If we actually talk about, if we talk further, if we discuss further, so you've got, Chandan, first of all, what you need to do is that you need to perform the analytical procedures. And once you have performed the analytical procedures, then you will have to actually identify the risk of material misstatement involved. So can you please guide me about the change in the PPE? That what is the change in the PPE? Furthermore, in addition to PPE, there's an intangible. And there is a split on between the goodwill, and in addition to the goodwill, there is actually the brand names. And in addition to the brand names, there is actually a development cost. So, can any one of you actually explain that what are the changes in these things? Additionally, if you could also calculate, Okay, now let's just discuss. So if we go through this question, we could have a discussion. We have actually performed some calculations, but what we need to do is that we need to highlight the risk. So if I talk about this question, what is actually happening in this question is, it says you are a manager in Holy and Co, a firm of chartered certified accountants, and you're responsible for the audit of Laurel Group, the group with a financial year ending 31st May 2017. The group produces cosmetics and beauty products sold under various brand names. So first of all, let's just try to understand. The group sells cosmetics and the beauty products, which are sold under the various brand names. So if you talk about the cosmetics and the beauty products, so cosmetics and beauty products would actually mean that when we talk about the cosmetics or the beauty products, that means that the inventory is something which can get outdated. They're sold under the various brand names, and in addition to this, it says that which are globally recognized and are sold in more than 100 countries, so and so. Now, Holy was appointed group auditor 3 years ago, and the firm audits all components of the group. We have not actually discussed about the group audit, but generally, what do you mean by a component? So, component is an entity or the business whose results are included in entity or the business whose results are included in financial statement of parent. So that is considered to be a component. So what's a component? A component is an entity, any entity whose results are included in the financial statement of a parent. That means a component could be your subsidiary, a component could be your associate, or a component could actually be your JV. This is all could be the component. Now, the group sells its products under the well-known brand names, which most of which have been acquired with subsidiary companies. Most of which have been acquired with subsidiary companies. Group is highly acquisitive, and there are more than 40 subsidiaries and 15 associates within the group. Now, one very important thing is when we talk about the risk of material misstatement, I did talk about that the risk of material misstatement is the risk that the financial statements are materially misstated. Now, financial statements could be misstated with respect to the non-compliance of the accounting standard or by the non-validity of the assertion. If I talk about this case, you might actually remember from your P2 that there is accounting standard which is related party standard IAS 24. And IAS 24 requires certain disclosures. IAS 24 requires certain disclosures with respect to the related party. And that is especially a disclosure with respect to name of parent entity in the books of subsidiary, and at the same time details of transactions with related parties. So, IAS 24 is applicable on the listed companies, and this company, the Holy Group, is already a listed company. It is mentioned in the upper part of the question that this is a listed company. So, if it's a listed company, that means that IAS 24 is applicable onto this company. So, basically, so if I talk about it, in fact, a listed company. So what we could actually discuss is that there is a risk that entity has not given appropriate disclosures in accordance with IAS 24 related parties. So you could highlight the risk like this, that there is a risk that the entity has not given appropriate disclosures in accordance with IAS 24 related parties. Okay, let's discuss further. So, if I say that the further risk is that the products include cosmetics, hair care products, and perfumes for men and women, research into the new products is a significant activity. So it says that research into the new product is a significant activity, and the group aims to bring new products to market on a regular basis. So generally, what happens is when we talk about this IS-38, when we talk about this IS-38, when we talk about this IS-38, the IS-38 actually talks about the research and development. And when we discuss IS-38, it says that the research cost should be expensed to P&L and development cost shall be recognized as asset if capitalization criteria is met. So, since the entity is involved in research and development, there's a risk that the research costs are recorded as asset. There is a further risk that development expenditure capitalized does not meet the criteria for recognition. So you've got these risks, which is one of them is that the research that there is that the research costs are recorded as an asset, and there's a further risk that the development cost or the development expenditure does not meet the criteria for recognition. If you move further, so there is this balance sheet, where is this property, plant, equipment, there's a reference to note number one. So if I refer to note number one, it says capital expenditure of 20 million has been recorded so far during the year. Group's accounting policy is to recognize assets at cost less depreciation. So it recognizes the asset using cost model. During the year, a review of assets estimated useful lives concluded that many were too short. And as a result, the projected depreciation charge for the year is $5 million, less than the comparative figure. During the year, a review of assets useful life estimated concluded that they were too short. Now, you see, one thing that you need to actually highlight over here is that the property, plant, equipment. Now, what are the risks associated with this capital expenditure? The change in the property, plant, equipment, there are two risks. Number one change is basically that the revenue nature expenditure is capitalized as cost of asset. So the first risk is that the revenue nature expenditure is capitalized as cost of the asset. The second thing is that the useful life estimate is incorrect, resulting in reduction in depreciation charge and overstatement of PPE balance. So you try to understand this thing that what is happening is when we talk about this property, plant, equipment, it says you could actually see that these are the various risks associated with the PPE, that the revenue nature expenditure might have been capitalized or the useful life estimate is incorrect, resulting in reduction in the depreciation charge. So these are the various risks. So basically what you need to think is you need to think that what could go wrong with these financial statements. So that's what you need to think. That what could go wrong with these financial statements. Now, if I move forward, so now next situation is that there's an intangible asset which is goodwill. The last year's goodwill was 18, and the current year goodwill is also 18. One thing that you need to remember with respect to goodwill is that IAS 36 states that the goodwill should always be tested for impairment at each reporting date. So the goodwill should always be tested for impairment at each reporting date. That's what IAS 36 states. Furthermore, if we say intangible assets, acquired brand names, there is a reference to note number 2. We will discuss that. There is also an intangible asset about the development cost. Last year it was 10, current year it's 25. So I've already discussed the risk related to the development assets. Now, if I say that I did mention that the risk that the research costs are recognized as an asset, there's a further risk that development expenditure does not meet capitalization criteria. Furthermore, if I talk about the goodwill, so goodwill is that IAS 36 requires goodwill to be tested for impairment at each reporting date. Now, here what you could do is that you could connect it with the declining sales, that the declining sales and unchanged balance of goodwill indicates that the entity has not tested or has not recognized the impairment. Sorry, the declining sales is an indication that goodwill might have been impaired, and the unchanged balance indicates that the of goodwill indicates that the entity has not tested or not recognized the impairment on goodwill. If we look at the current assets have gone up. We are going to discuss these acquired brand names, that what has happened with acquired brand names. It says the acquired brand names are held at cost and not amortized on the grounds that the assets have an indefinite life. So it says the assets are held at cost and are not amortized, that they have an indefinite life. Now, annual impairment reviews are conducted on all brand names. December 2016, the Chico brand name was determined to be impaired by 30 million due to allegations made in the press and by customers that some of the ingredients used in Chico perfume range can cause a skin irritation and more serious health problem. The Chico products have been withdrawn from sale. Now you see, have a discussion about the what exactly is the risk of material misstatement. So whenever we talk about the risk of material misstatement, you need to understand that you are trying to actually highlight, you are at the planning stage, you are trying to think what could go wrong with these finances. Because I am an auditor, I need to understand, I need to identify that what are the risky areas of this company. So if I figure out this specific area of acquired brand names, so this acquired brand names gives rise to a lot of things. Now, what is this acquired brand name give rise to a lot of things? So let me discuss. I have actually talked about this intangible. One of them was the research and development, the other one of them was a goodwill. So the acquired brand name, if I share with you what IAS 36 states, IAS 36 and IAS 38. IAS 36 and IAS 38 in conjunction, when you read them in conjunction, she would figure out that IAS 36 and IAS 38 state that an asset with indefinite life to be tested for impairment at each reporting date, number one. Number two, in case. Furthermore, what you need to do is that test them for life estimate at each reporting date. So it's not just about testing them for impairment, it's about testing them for impairment and at the same time testing them for the life estimate at each reporting date. Now, the indication of impairment, the recognition of impairment is an indication that recognition of impairment is an indication that the useful life can now be estimated for the So the recognition is an impairment is indicating the useful life can now be estimated for the branch. Now, what is actually the risk? So we need to actually identify the risk. Now, risk is that number one, that number one of them is basically the useful life estimate not made intentionally. Amortization not recognized. So these are the risks associated with this specific asset. So when we talk about the risk, so this is something that you need to do. You need to think that what could go wrong with the financial statements. You need to think that where could the entity make a mistake, and that is actually where the risk lies, and that's what you need to find out. Now, one more thing that you would read from this Chico brand name. And what is that that you would actually read from this specific area, which is the specific area pertaining to this, is that the Chico products have been withdrawn. Chico products have been withdrawn. So now if they have been withdrawn, so that means they would be reflected in inventory and included in current assets. If the Chico products have been withdrawn, that means they have been reflected in the inventory and they are included in current assets. That is the reason for the overstatement of, that is the reason for increase in current asset probably. Now, we have got evidence that there is a need to write down these inventories. So if we talk from the perspective of the audit, so what exactly is the risk? If we think from the perspective of the audit, the risk is that the inventories have not been written down. The risk is inventories have not been written down below the lower of cost or NRV. So this is what has happened with respect to current assets. The capital remains the same. Retained earnings have increased slowly. Non-controlling interest remains the same. So NCI being same indicates a problem. Now, why is NCI showing a problem? Because what happens is that you have reflected the profit for the year as 25. Now, if there is a profit for the year, then such profit needs to be attributed to the NCI also, because a group entity, a parent entity with a group financial statement, these are the group financial statement, right? Consolidated financial statement. So if there are consolidated financial statements, that means obviously the profit or the loss shall be attributed to NCI also. The NCI balance needs to be changed. The NCI balance needs to change, and the NCI balance hasn't changed. So what does this indicate? NCI balance, this actually indicates that the profit slash loss has not been attributed to NCI. Has not been attributed to NCI. The profits or loss has not been attributed to NCI. Now let's just discuss further. There is a debenture loans where there is an increase of 20, and there's a deferred tax where there's an increase of 8. Now see what has happened with them. So if we go through this number 3, it says a $20 million loan was taken out in January. The cash being used to finance a specific new product development project. So if we say that we have a year end of 31st May 2017, it says a $20 million loan was taken out in January 2017. The cash being used to finance a specific new product development project. So the debenture loan. There's an accounting standard which says IS 23 borrowing costs. And in accordance with IS 23, the borrowing cost incurred for the construction or acquisition of a qualifying asset shall be recognized as cost of qualifying asset. Now, here if you look at the profit and loss account, the profit and loss account, the finance cost is unchanged. In the profit and loss account, the finance cost is unchanged. And you look at SOFP, the loan balance has been obtained. Now apparently, and we do know that the development asset has also increased. So apparently what seems that the finance cost has been capitalized as part of the cost of the asset, but we are an auditor and we need to maintain our professional skepticism, and our professional skepticism says that there could be something wrong, because the borrowing cost actually is one of those standards that's not applied on a daily basis. It's not something that's a daily routine matter. So the entity could make a error in this application of the borrowing cost. So what is gonna be the risk? So the we are gonna say that the risk with respect to this is, number one, borrowing costs do not meet capitalization criteria, or maybe they have not been recognized on accrual basis. Now, the next thing is the deferred tax liability relates to timing differences in respect of accelerated tax depreciation. The liability has increased following changes to estimated useful lives of the asset as discussed in the note 1. So now, the deferred tax liability has increased. If I look at the expenses, so you could see that the tax expense has actually became is unchanged. Now we don't really understand that what have they done with the change in the deferred tax liability, because the liability has decreased. So what have they done? Have they recognized them with a part of the asset or what? Because you see the tax expense is unchanged. How could the tax expense be unchanged? If there is an 8 million increase in the liability, then how could the tax expense be unchanged? So there is a risk of incorrect treatment of tax expense. Now you see, these are few risks, and furthermore, the other risk that we have actually done is that we could relate to the declining sales to the inventory write down. Impairment of goodwill, impairment of intangibles, and PPE. Because the declining sales would mean declining cash flows, and the declining cash flows would actually mean that the declining cash flows would actually mean that the ultimately the value in was good value in use would go down, and there is a risk of impairment. So I think this is the overall risk that we have discussed in this question. Now let me actually go through the question again and see and discuss few things. So for the questions that you have raised, just wait for a while. I'm gonna answer every single question that you have actually asked. Don't worry about that. So the question's requirement was that you need to evaluate the risk of material misstatement to be considered in planning the group audit. Your evaluation should analyze the analytic should utilize the analytical procedure as a method for identifying the relevant risk. Now, one thing is that this is what we need to do. The 16 mark question. You should your evaluation should utilize the analytical procedure. So if I say that how are these 16 marks allocated, so you could say that 4 to 5 marks would be for the analytical procedures, and then the 11 marks would be splitted like at 1.5 marks are risk. So you need to actually identify 11 divided by 1.5. This actually leads to around 7 risks that you need to identify. Number one, and you need to actually have 4 or 5 marks for the analytical procedures that you perform. So this is what the overall the question's demand is. So you need to actually how now the question mark that actually arises from the student's perspective is, sir, how will we actually present it? So you perform the analytical procedure, and once you perform the analytical procedure, then you discuss the risk. Now, one more aspect where you could gain marks is actually wherever there are numbers discussed. Like here, we had a capital expenditure of 20 million. So if there was a capital expenditure of 20 million, you could have compared this 20 million with the total assets. The total assets of the entity are 358. You could have compared it with this. So it would have been whatever the percentage, you could have commented that it's material or immaterial. Then similarly, there was a discussion of impairment loss, and the impairment loss could actually be compared impairment loss of 30 could actually be compared with the PBT, and you could comment on it being material. Then there was another number, and that was actually the loan balance. So if we call upon the loan balance could also be compared with the total assets. The loan balance could also be compared with the total assets. So we could say that 20 divided by then again 358. So it's then again either material or immaterial. That's what you can do. You can get extra marks for that. So, we have got other requirements to the question, but I'm not going to actually discuss those requirements right now. We might actually defer it to the tomorrow's session. But I think this is something that I wanted to go through, which is we have done two things. We have actually identified how the risk of material misstatement arises. We have identified that what are the how do we perform the analytical procedures and how do we interpret the risk from these analytical procedures. So what I'm gonna do is that I'm gonna stop the discussion pertaining to the question right now. At this stage, I will continue this question tomorrow. But what I am going to do is I'm going to answer the questions that you have asked me over the last 1 hour or so. And whosoever has got further questions, you could share those. You could write down those questions. Okay. One thing is, Aliza Khan, you have asked for the link to the group. I think there are a few students who have already joined the P7 group. And I'm telling you one thing that please abstain from kindly. I mean, it would be very good if you could abstain from if you could please avoid. It will be really good if you could please avoid doing irrelevant discussion in the group, because that's very important. The reason behind that is a lot of the students I've seen, they actually do useless discussions in the group, and that really affects the main purpose and the main objective of the group. So kindly avoid doing that. This is a request to all of you. Kindly avoid doing that. I'm going to share the group's link. I need to join the webinar from my mobile phone so that I could share the link with you people. If somebody has the link, could you please share it? Okay. So let me Kaiser, risk of material misstatement. Kaiser Fayaz, you have already mentioned it. Okay. Okay, then there is this. Can we solve the question or discussion of points by now? Hopefully, everyone would have gone through the question and also. Yes, Junaid Bajwa, I think I had given some time, but anyways. Now, additions during the year are also 25% revenue increase, so and so, so and so, so and so. Chandan, I think you did understand the requirement. So Maya, you mentioned that sir, for goodwill can we write there is a risk that it is not impaired if the amount did not change. Yes, I think we did discuss that. Could we get the material which you writing means solution of question? Okay. Khwaja, I would ask my administrator to do that. As to how many risks are identified for 16 marks, Sidra, I think I have actually discussed that how many risks you need to identify. Identify risks related to each element in the balance sheet. Sidra, I think whatever the risk is, you do need to identify the risk pertaining to wherever there is a wherever you think that there's something could have gone wrong. So I think you need to wait for one more day. Because for the next day, I mean, we would have one more question, so it would be a better, it would be much better. Arslan, I think you do understand that the finance cost, there is not a risk of understatement. There's a risk that it might not have been capitalized. Yes, Junaid, we need to calculate the materiality with the relevant elements, etc. Anas Merchant 48, let me come over to your discussion. Franklin, yes, I would ask my team to actually share that Word document. Okay, Chandan, I think you missed out. I did discuss that you need to I did discuss that you need to perform the risk I think I mean I did discuss that what you need to do. But anyways, I would make sure that I discuss the requirement more before I give you people time to study. Abrar, you're asking, can you please tell again on which figures can we comment? We can comment regarding materiality. What to divide with what? I mean, you see that when we talk about material, whatever that you have a figure coming in the discussion, or you could compare that figure with the relevant figure. Relevant figure means that if you are talking something pertaining to an asset, you compare it with the total asset. If you're talking about something pertaining to sales, you compare it with the sale. You've got something that is pertaining to be recognized in P&L, then you compare it with the PBT figure. Azimullah Bhatti, what happens is that you're saying that finance cost capitalized mean that it should be added to the loan balance. You see, the loan has already been obtained. It's the double entry is cash debit loan credit. But what about the finance cost? The finance cost should be generally it's finance cost debit and cash credit. But now, when IAS 23 applies, it says finance cost is not debited, instead the asset is debited and we say the cash is credited. Fariha, I think I did discuss about how materiality is ascertained. All that you need to do in order to establish materiality is simply that you need to compare the item under discussion with the relevant figure of the profit or the total assets or the revenue. Okay, Chandan, non-validity of assertion actually means that there are various assertions. Like when we talk about the various assertion, we say that the various assertions include the completeness, cutoff, etc. So the financial statements, while preparing financial, management says that we have prepared the financials considering all these aspects are present. Like the financials are complete, the cutoff has been complied, the classification has been correct, etc., etc., etc. So if any of the assertion is invalid, that's a non-compliance of assertion and that's a misstatement. Mohsen Hassan Khan, you use the most relevant figure. You use the most relevant item for calculating the materiality. Okay, are there any other questions? Are there any other questions? Yeah, loan is a balance sheet item. Adeem, I did discuss the borrowing cost question, and the borrowing cost is basically that the risk is the borrowing cost might not have been capitalized, because you see the loan was obtained in January and the year end is 31st May, so it's 5 months down the line. So you might not have actually paid the loan, so you might not have actually capitalized it also. So basically there is a risk that the loan has, the interest on loan has not been capitalized because it has not been accrued actually. Farasat Ali, I'm not getting your question. I don't know. I don't know what exactly are you trying to say that when it comes, why is it P3? I mean, I'm just saying that these are the models that you study at P3 level. So the Pester and the Porter 5 forces model can help you identify the external environment of the entity. Chandan, the question regarding Pester and Porter 5 forces could be with respect to the business risk. Azeem, $7 is not the loan on this interest. $7 is the loan or the finance cost that the entity was incurring in the last year also. That was on the existing balance of the loan. It's actually new loan on which the interest might be incurred. Anas Marjan, 48 failure. All that you need to do is that you need to just practice writing and just need to pick out a few things where you could score more, and you will inshallah get through in this session. Don't worry about it. Anyways, I think it's time to call it off now. What we are going to do is that we are going to start off the session tomorrow, and we are going to continue with the same question, and we are going to attempt the requirement. The objective of this whole exercise, the objective of this whole session is basically that we do the quality stuff. I am not going to focus upon quantity. I'm going to focus upon quality, and my focus is going to be that we should do limited questions, but those questions should be done in such a perfect manner that you are able to attend as many questions as possible. Okay, I'll save my answer, and I would ask the admin personnel to actually share this answer with you. And what I will actually try to do is that I would try to keep this whole of the webinar into one single slide so that it could be shared. P7 December 2017. Anyways, thank you very much. Let's meet up tomorrow, inshallah.